Albert Edward, the new King Edward VII, was already 59 years old. The funeral of the Queen Empress and Edward's coronation involved a huge invention of traditions and ceremonies. And in this atmosphere, it's not surprising that Edward was granted an annual allowance even greater than Victoria's. A few voices said that it was unnecessary for the king to have as big an income as Andrew Carnegie, the Bill Gates of his day, but no one took much notice. Edward had been given a miserable and oppressive childhood. Victoria had measured him by the impossible yardstick of her hero worship of the perfect man, his father. Naturally, young Bertie had rebelled. Of course, his first visit to a prostitute shocked his parents deeply. It happened to be followed by Albert's fatal illness, which Victoria had inevitably blamed on her wicked son. She had arranged his marriage shortly afterwards in the hope that domestic discipline would rein him in. Princess Alex of Denmark was beautiful, but she was also deaf and dull company. With nothing much else to do, Bertie had become the living epitome of the life of the Belle Époque, a life of champagne drinking, cigar smoking, horse racing, gambling and entertaining showgirls and pretty married ladies. He was naturally drawn to the company of outsiders, not just shady characters, but Jews and Catholics, bankers and foreigners, and he was outspokenly outraged by the casual racism of the empire. "Because a man has a black face and a different religion than our own, there is no reason why he should be treated as a brute." He sat on a commission on working class housing and even invited a member of the working class to stay at Sandringham. Admittedly, the man in question was an MP and a fellow member of the commission, and he had to eat in his bedroom because he didn't have the right clothes to come down to dinner. But still... By the time Edward came to the throne, he was a big, fat old man with a social conscience and a comforting mistress, Alice Keppel, who understood him perfectly. Edward saw himself as something like a nursery rhyme monarch, magnificent and jolly, caring and helpful. In 1903, completely ignoring his government, he went to France and started negotiations for a treaty that would become the Entente Cordiale, isolating Germany. He detested his nephew, the Kaiser. He persuaded the press and then the government to back a treaty which guaranteed that if Germany attacked France, Britain would go to war. So that's what happened in 1914. He determinedly resisted any increase in democracy in Britain and was a firm opponent of votes for women. The crunch over his reactionary views came when Lloyd George planned to introduce old age pensions in 1909. To raise the cash, there would have to be new taxes on income. The Tory majority in the House of Lords voted down what was called the People's Budget, and when the Liberal government drew up legislation to take that power away from the Lords, they voted that down too, obviously. So the Prime Minister told the King he needed to create about 250 new peers to swing the vote. Edward was not enthusiastic. Would he actually defy the government? In May 1910, in the middle of the battle, he died.